We have some news involving the 2024 US presidential campaign, particularly involving Cenk Uygur, presidential candidate. There is some news from New Hampshire. We will get to that in our interview with Cenk in just a moment. But first, a full disclosure to some of you who may think, wow, this is a little bit awkward. Yes, I have worked for Cenk and TYT for the last 2 years. I've been friends with Cenk for a lot longer than that, and I have publicly and privately endorsed his presidential campaign and volunteered to do anything to help his effort. However, for the next 30 minutes, I'm gonna take off that hat and put on the hat of straight news journalist and ask all the tough questions, including some adversarial ones that I would ask of any candidate, including one who was in the position that Cenk is in now. So with that, let's get started and welcome Cenk Uygur to the program. Cenk, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, David.
All right, Cenk, there's news out of New Hampshire. You're getting a hearing this Thursday from the Election Ballot Law Commission. What does that mean and how significant is this to your campaign?
Yes, so what we've done is we're filling out all the normal forms to get on ballots in different states like Nevada and New Hampshire. We've been on time, we've followed every guideline there is. And so far, those two forms have had some version of language of you need to be a natural born citizen to be on the ballot. Now, we believe that that is incorrect. The FEC has already ruled that you can run as a naturalized citizen. The question is left up to the Supreme Court as to whether you could serve as a naturalized citizen. And we're going to make the argument to the Ballot Law Commission in New Hampshire that they should not make this decision, the courts should. And we have an excellent legal argument for that that we're going to unveil at that hearing on Thursday, 10 a.m. in New Hampshire. And from my perspective, I would love as many people who are interested in this campaign to show up there in Concord at the Ballot Law Commission hearing as they can. At 9:15 a.m. is when we're gonna gather, and then at 10 a.m. is the hearing. And we're going to argue to get me on the ballot. And if we win that case, I would be the first naturalized citizen on a presidential ballot ever.
Now, I've heard the argument made from other people who are naturalized US citizens born outside the United States, whether it's the Ted Cruz campaign or supporters of Arnold Schwarzenegger or Jennifer Granholm when they were hoping that somehow they would get in the race, that the Constitution, yes, was originally written, you have to be 35, born in the United States, or a naturalized citizen at the time of the writing. But there's this argument that the 14th Amendment, the Due Process Clause, could in fact amend that, or a court could look at the 14th Amendment and say, no, wait a second, maybe the 14th Amendment gives somebody who's a naturalized citizen the same rights and privileges as somebody who was born in the United States. Is that sort of where you're going here?
Yes, so the 14th Amendment says that anyone born or naturalized has due process and equal protection of the laws. They did not put an asterisk in the amendment saying, except for naturalized citizens in the case of the presidential race. No, it was an amendment that amended the earlier discriminatory parts of the Constitution. So in the original Constitution, it says that that African Americans are 3/5 of a person. That was obviously amended out of the Constitution, even though you could open up the Constitution and see it in the original Constitution, it doesn't mean that it applies. The 14th Amendment, we will argue, has done the same thing for the clause saying that naturalized citizens are basically second class citizens and cannot run for president of the United States. We believe that has already been amended out, and it couldn't be any clearer than the 14th Amendment saying born or naturalized. So now there's many other cases that we're gonna cite, including the FEC case saying that there's no question that we should be able to run for the office. And we believe that New Hampshire should get their say. And so that's why we're encouraging people to come out, not only, and if you can bring signs that says let them run, but more importantly in New Hampshire, the signs that say let us vote. Because New Hampshire is an important voice here, and they could use that voice to actually affect this issue. So if I'm on the ballot, Joe Biden is not running in New Hampshire because of a disagreement that he had with New Hampshire and the DNC. So he's going to be running in South Carolina, but not in New Hampshire. I could actually win that state. And not only could it, I believe I can win all the states, obviously, but that one is particularly very realistic. And you should let the voters of New Hampshire weigh in on that. And so that's why I'm inviting all press, all supporters to come there. And obviously you could find out more at jankforamerica.com and facebook.com/jankugerofficial, where we'll be giving more campaign updates. But it's at the State Archives Building, Non-Ratification Way, Concord, New Hampshire, 9:15 a.m. on Thursday is when we're gathering. And I wanted everybody to make sure that they know in case they support it.
I want to let the control room know that I'm aware that I'm having a technical issue with the camera here, and that's why you're not seeing streaming video, and I'll try to get that fixed. But Cenk, when you announced a few weeks ago that you were running, you said you were running as a proxy for any other candidate. There is another candidate, another Democrat in the race, Minnesota House member Dean Phillips. He has also said that Joe Biden cannot beat Donald Trump and that therefore there has to be another Democrat. He has also said his primary issue is campaign finance reform. So does he qualify as that other Democrat? And if not, why not?
So it's a good question. First of all, Dean Phillips and I disagree on many different issues. He's more of an establishment Democrat. Obviously, I'm a progressive Democrat. And so while he says he's for campaign finance reform, I would love for him to have the position of banning corporate PAC money and not taking corporate PAC money. And by the way, I'd like to clarify something I said on a couple of interviews, including here on the Young Turks. Since the DNC has not banned super PAC money in primaries, I'm open to that. I don't think that any year is going to come, but I'm not going to unilaterally disarm. But I will not take any corporate PAC money. No way, right? So I would encourage Representative Phillips to do likewise, not only in his campaign, but also when he's in the House, because he's a representative. But I like that Dean Phillips got in the race. So like the traditional politicians say, me, right? I'm not saying that at all. I love that Dean Phillips got in the race. I want more people to get in the race. And I want us to have a super strong primary. And I want the Democratic voters to decide. And if they like me best among all those choices, wonderful. If they like Dean Phillips more, great. But why am I and Dean Phillips and Marianne Williamson not sufficient is as part of the point of your question, I think, David. And so look, if they allowed for a debate and we had a real primary, then we are perfectly sufficient. Right, but since the DNC is saying we're going to shut out everyone else, and this is not a real democracy as long as the DNC runs it, what we're going to do is end all debates and all discussion about this, etc. We need, much more importantly, we need Joe Biden to drop out. I mean, he's being intensely selfish. 2/3 of Americans do not want him to run. 2/3 of Democrats don't want him to run. He's 80 years old. He's at 37% on the polling. So I think what Dean and I are saying is similar in that get everybody in this race. This is not fair to Democratic voters that the DNC and the Democratic Party is saying, no, we're going to pick an incredibly weak candidate who's polling at 37% when we think democracy is on the line. And no one is allowed to contest that. So we disagree. I hope Governor Newsom, Governor Whitmer, Governor Beshear, Governor Shapiro, Governor Pritzker, that they all come in. And I would love to do a debate with all of them. So let's have the strongest possible primary to have the strongest possible candidate.
When you were asked about Marianne Williamson a couple weeks ago, you said, well, she has not broken through, and therefore that was another reason for you to get in. Is that the threshold? And at what point do you determine whether you or whether, you know, Dean has broken through or anybody else, any other Democrat? At what point do you say, okay, now we need to coalesce in order to defeat the Democratic establishment candidate, President Biden?
Yeah, I think that's easy. So logically, as soon as we have the primaries, that you'll sort that out. So let's take a hypothetical. Let's say that Governor Josh Shapiro, Biden drops out, or Biden stays in and Governor Josh Shapiro comes in anyway. He's the governor of Pennsylvania, beat a Trump acolyte by 15 points easily. He would nearly guarantee the state of Pennsylvania, which is one of the swing states that Joe Biden is losing. Joe Biden is losing 5 out of 7 swing states. The point here, guys, is to beat Donald Trump. And we should not defer to authority and go, oh, well, our dear leader, even though he's polling terribly and is almost guaranteed a loss, we have to bow our heads to him and do whatever he says. No, I think I'm the right candidate. Jankforamerica.com. But if it turns out, David, that we have a primary race and Governor Shapiro wins easily in Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, and he's sitting at 55% and I'm sitting at 5%, of course I'm not going to continue to go on. And then I'm happy to unite behind whichever Democrat is opposed to Donald Trump. because the whole point is to beat Donald Trump. And I don't want to go into a fight with Donald Trump with a wounded antelope who refuses to campaign, who refuses to make arguments for him. Running against him, I've made better arguments in favor of Joe Biden than he has. So for example, he's down 19 points on jobs. He doubled the number of jobs Donald Trump created. What is wrong with you, Joe Biden? If you're gonna be an egomaniac and say, me, my legacy matters more. I have to be a two-term president because two-term presidents get better legacies. Well then God damn it, run and make a case against Donald Trump. Why are you losing by 19 points to Donald Trump on an issue where you doubled him? I have told more Americans now that Joe Biden has doubled the number of jobs that Trump created than Joe Biden has, and by a lot. If you're gonna take a nap, go home and take a nap. But if you're gonna run for president, then run. But he's not doing either. He's condemning all of us Democrats, and honestly, the entire country and entire democracy. And he's saying, I don't care if we lose democracy, as long as I have a shot at two terms. My ego is the most important thing in the world. I don't agree. And David, you asked a good question. Why me? Why not just Dean Phillips? Why not just Marianne Williamson? Does it look like Dean Phillips makes this kind of case? Dean Phillips politely goes in and goes, well, I love Joe Biden. I think he's right about everything, but golly gee, I wish he'd get out of the race. No, you gotta push him out of the race. Sorry, brother. The incumbents under 50% don't win. Incumbents under 40%, they literally never win, never. And he's at 37%. I'm not gonna sit here and lose to Donald Trump because everybody in Washington wants to kiss up to Joe Biden.
Is it possible that that's what's going on though, that this isn't about Joe Biden's ego per se, but rather that just the inner circle around him have been telling him, look, you don't worry about the polls, everything's fine. You got the Democratic establishment behind you. There's no way that Donald Trump, given all he's going through, is gonna beat you. And that for him, it's not so much about ego, he's just making a political calculation, which again, it's not as nefarious as suggesting that Joe Biden's ego is gonna ruin the country. But is it possible it's something a little bit more innocent involving President Biden?
No. I think that Joe Biden has been an egomaniac his whole life. Everyone who talks to him will tell you, you can't get in a word edgewise because the guy loves the sound of his own voice. He doesn't let anybody else talk. It's all me. Why? Why would you? He said he was going to be a transition president. Why would you run again when you're 80? Everyone on planet Earth can see you're having cognitive difficulties. You're pulling at 37%, you're losing 5 out of 7 swing states. You're losing to 10 points with independents. You're down 15 points from when you barely beat Trump last time. Look, if someone's got a better answer, David, I'm not even sure I think there are good people around him who are probably encouraging him to do the right thing. And by the way, the great news for Joe Biden is if he retires now, he retires an American hero. He beat Donald Trump, he created over 14 million jobs, good steward of the economy, and bows out gracefully. Then all the history books write Joe Biden as a hero. If he loses the country on his watch, he becomes one of the primary villains of American history. He's not a normal candidate. If Josh Shapiro or Gavin Newsom loses, well, hey, the Democrats chose the best candidate they thought had the best chance, and they lost in a normal race. And they at least started above Trump. Every one of those governors would start the race significantly above Trump instead of below Trump, right? But if Biden loses to Trump, history's gonna look back and go, why did you run when you were at 37%? Why did you run where every sane political analyst thought you were gonna lose? And you said democracy was on the line, and you played dice with democracy because you wanted a second term? So, you know, David, I know you're asking me questions. I don't know what your opinion is, but I don't see any other reason why Joe Biden is in this race other than his gigantic, ridiculous ego, which is endangering the entire country.
It's also an ego, of course, that's not just for Joe Biden, though. I would argue it's also the Democratic National Committee. And in fact, the reaction to Dean Phillips getting the race, Minnesota's own governor, Tim Walz, who's a Democrat, who's a friend of Dean Phillips, he sort of bristled at the notion that Dean Phillips would get. And he said, we're gonna have our nominee in President Biden, and that will get done. That immediate dismissiveness from the DNC, what do you make of it? And have you heard anything directly yourself from the DNC or from people close to President Biden?
Yeah, no, President Biden's team has bought a couple of websites that are a variation of my website. So it's obvious that they've noticed and they're a little worried. Good. The correct website is jenkforamerica.com, and I probably got under their skin by buying bidenisgoingtolose.com, and it redirects to my campaign website, so they did likewise. But with Dean Phillips, they've launched all the ships. And because in their Washington minds, they're like outsiders, like Americans would want populist progressives like John Fetterman. Oops. Oh, there's no way an outsider is gonna win. I mean, they're not even corrupt. They won't even take corporate back money. So they view me as a smaller threat. I'm being honest about it. But when Dean Phillips got in, they're like, oh, he's a congressperson. That is an important privileged person. Okay, so he since he's a human being and he counts, we're gonna attack him with all we got. So every mainstream media article has attack quotes against Dean Phillips from Democrats. So this is the standard smear job that the DNC does to any Democrat that isn't picked by a dear leader. The Democratic Party is not supposed to be the authoritarian party, that's supposed to be the Republican Party, but the DNC has turned it into totally authoritarian. Everyone must bow their head to the weak leader who is almost definitely going to lose. Otherwise, you'll be smeared to no end. So everyone is out there smearing Dean Phillips. Oh, he shouldn't run. Molly Jong-Fest, who I like otherwise, said that he was a privileged white guy. What do you think Joe Biden is? It doesn't get any more privileged than no one should be allowed to run against me. I am the king. I mean, president. DNC, tell him I'm king. Right?
Phillips may be a little bit privileged because he married into a distillery family and is worth something like $70 million. I mean, he's sitting on a lot of money, so maybe he's privileged in that regard.